so I think we're talking about type 2 superconductors, we have to start discussing what is the superconductor. So superconductor, and for that matter superfluid, are two very, very closely linked phenomena. The difference between them is that superconductivity refers to particles which are charged, and superfluidity refers to particles which are not charged. But other than that, they're almost identical. So what are superconductors? So I'm sure everyone knows one of the manifestations of superconductivity, which means that if you take a superconductor and you try to flow a current in that superconductor, you will not experience any resistance. Conductivity will be infinite. That's one manifestation. But where it all comes from? It all comes from the fact that particles, so in that, in case of superconductors, would be electrons in solids, they quantum mechanically go into the same state. So instead of being independent particles, they occupy one microscopic object, which is quantum mechanical. So normally, quantum mechanics only appears at the level of a single particle, and on the microscopic scale, things behave classically. But in superconductors, that's not the case. A lot of electrons occupy one massive, large microscopic quantum state. And because they are part of one state, you can imagine that if they flow and they meet some obstacle on the way, of course, it's only one of those electrons meeting the obstacle, the others are farther away. But if they are from one state, obviously this one cannot scatter, because otherwise we'll just leave that microscopic state. So that's a very intuitive explanation. But if you think from more scientific point of view, more from the point of view of energy, it means that if you have this microscopic object inside your solid, the excitations above that microscopic object are energetically not possible, because the relation between energy and momentum is changed in the presence of this microscopic object. Normally, atoms or any particles will have a quadratic relation between energy and momentum. And here, in the case of superconductors, this relation will be changed. So energetically, it's not possible to create an excitation. And this is where this frictionless flow comes from. So the lack of resistance or lack of fluidity in case of the superfluid is only one manifestation of superconductivity. Superconductivity is something much, much more profound, and superfluidity is that because you have a microscopic object, you are dealing with a microscopic object, which is described by the microscopic wave function, which has amplitude and phase. If you now try to calculate a current going through the superconductor or a flow in the superfluid, it's quantum mechanically is the gradient of phase, which is the current or the superflow. Now, we know that mathematically that curl of the gradient of the function is equal to zero, and curl describes rotation. So because all these particles are occupying one microscopic state, this state is irrotational. If you take a liquid helium and you try to rotate a bucket, the liquid helium will not rotate. And a very related phenomena is called Meissner effect, is that the magnetic field will not penetrate a superconductor. It will be expelled out of the superconductor. That was the belief that the superconductivity and magnetism cannot coexist. They're not compatible with each other. And that was the case indeed in the case of so-called type 1 superconductors. So what it means that if I take a superconductor and I put a magnetic field, it will expel magnetic field. If I increase and increase magnetic field, finally the superconductivity will break, the magnetic field will enter superconductor, but I have superconductivity completely gone. And this happens as a first order phase transition, so it happens just you have no magnetic field and superfluidity, and then immediately after, if one increase the magnetic field below critical value, I have full magnetic field inside and no superconductivity there. That was the understanding how superconductivity and magnetism cannot coincide to start with in the discovery of superconductivity with the first materials which were discovered. However, experimentally, another type of material were discovered where this appeared not to be true. So there was some coexistence of magnetism and superconductivity, and there were two critical magnetic fields. So if one is increasing the magnetic field to start with, there will be some magnetization inside, so there will be some magnetic field allowed inside, but still superconductivity will exist. But as the magnetic field is increased even more, there will be a second critical field in which the superconductivity is gone. So I will have, there will be a range of magnetic fields between a first critical point and the second critical point where superconductivity and magnetism can coexist. So it was a puzzle how that can be possible. And there are two important people who were able to shine light on that mystery. So first was Ginzburg and Landau, who proposed Ginzburg-Landau theory of superconductivity, and it was initially proposed as a theory to explain superconductivity in the presence of magnetic field and in the presence of the current in order to determine what is the critical current or what is the critical magnetic field in that case. And indeed, it worked very well for these type 1 superconductors. However, so Ginzburg-Landau theory is a phenomenological theory. It's not a microscopic theory. They don't tell you why something happens. They just describe something which is happening. And they suggested an order parameter, which is a microscopic complex wave function. If this order parameter is finite, is larger than zero, we have superconductivity. If this order parameter is zero, we don't have superconductivity. Now, the parameters of this equation will depend on the material, so you can, different materials will have different parameters, and also some of these parameters will depend on temperature and on magnetic field. So by changing the temperature and magnetic field, we can get the transition. So when Ginzburg and Landau suggested the theory, there was an important parameter in the theory, which is called kappa, and basically it's a fraction between magnetic penetration depth and coherence length. So magnetic penetration depth is something, if you imagine you have a superconductor and you have an interface to a normal, you have a superconducting state and a normal state. Of course, superconductivity will not decay immediately. There will be some kind of gradual change, and the same magnetic field will not just decay instantly at the edge of the superconductor, it will penetrate a bit into the superconductor. So the how much it penetrates is described by this penetration depth and the length scale over which superconductor order parameter or superfluid order parameter decays is described by the coherence length. So the ratio between the two appeared to be extremely important parameter. So if this ratio is smaller than 1/√2, we are dealing with type 1 superconductors, so the one which I described. However, if this ratio is larger, there is something which Ginzburg and Landau noticed already proposing the theory. Something happens, namely, one can show that it is possible to have a superconducting state in the presence of the magnetic field, and also that the energy of the interface between the normal state and the superconductive state is negative. So actually, by making puddles in the superconductor, so by maximizing this surface energy, one can actually lower the total energy of the system. So these ideas were then picked up by Ginzburg, Abrikosov, who used Ginzburg-Landau theory to look at those experiments which actually showed coexistence between magnetism and superconductivity. And what he came up was that he found solutions to Ginzburg-Landau equations which minimized the energies, but they were in the form of vortices. So you can imagine what is a vortex. So if you have it's easy to imagine if you have a water and you have water flowing around like in a sink. So you have these currents going around, but in the middle of that of those currents going around, you don't have any water. So it's like in a sink. So now, in the case of superconductors or superfluids, a vortex means that your phase of the order parameter is going around. Yes, the phase can only go from 0 to 2 pi, so you have a branch cut at where it has to wind around. But then, in the middle, the phase is undefined. But that's fine because you don't have any superfluid order parameter there. So Abrikosov suggested that a good solution for Ginzburg-Landau equation in this parameter regime where kappa is larger than 1 over square root of 2 would be to create vortices, and these vortices will arrange in the lattices. And the larger the magnetic field, the more vortices you have, and the smaller separation between them. And the smaller the magnetic field, the distance between vortices will be larger. And now, a kind of nature can use that fact that the magnetic field will be pushed inside those vortices. So inside the vortex, you don't have the superconductivity, you don't have superconducting order parameter, but that's where magnetic field is placed. And now, with the increase of magnetic field, you have more of these vortices, so more magnetic field can be accumulated there until the vortices will start overlapping and you lose your superconducting state. So that was the theory of Ginzburg-Landau, and then used by Abrikosov could explain this behavior in some materials where magnetism and superconductivity could coexist. And now, why this was important? Like, why do we care about type 2 superconductors? So actually, by now, there are more type 2 superconductors than type 1 superconductors. All high-temperature superconductors are type 2 superconductors. And moreover, at that time, it was also important because you wanted to make use of superconductivity somehow. And one use of it would be to create strong magnetic fields. Because if you want to create a strong magnetic field, the way to do it is to put a current inside, let's say, a metal. But if you put a current inside a metal, finally the metal will heat up. Like if you want to put more current, there will be more losses, and it's not very efficient. Whereas imagine you have a current in a superconductor. You can put larger and larger current without losses. But at the same time, superconductivity doesn't allow the magnetic field to be there. So if you have a type 2 superconductors, which magnetic field and superconductivity can coexist, one can create large magnetic fields. And the superconducting magnets are basically the ones which are being used in nuclear magnetic resonance for MRI and all the medical applications, for example. So that was the one thing which was important from type 2 superconductors, but also because type 2 superconductors are the ones which are now, all of these high temperature superconductors are type 2 superconductors, it also gave a step to understand those, although of course the area of type 2 superconductors is completely an open area now, and more discoveries are essential to understand what is the mechanism of pairing. And although there are type 2, the theory of Ginzburg-Landau and Abrikosov are, of course, not enough to explain everything which is present in these new materials.